first race of the season.
We're in pretty good stint, you know, fighting out for third or fourth spot, and then we're catching right up.
Here we go, sending it hard. No hooks.
Had the boat fully lit up there coming into the finish. We're doing 31, 32 knots.
Oh my lord, Sam, you're slingshotting into orbits.
Sam, you're right, mate? We're gonna sink! Get the top of the rig!
These things have gone that fast, but not as hard. We're pushing the boundaries. Not to finish third or fourth in that race is disappointing, let alone missing out on further races.
Welcome to Geelong, Victoria for the second leg of the Superfoiler Grand Prix. Here on Corio Bay, our machines are ready to play.
Yeah, look Nick, it's typical weather here in Victoria. There's a front forecast to come through tonight, which has made the wind quite unpredictable, and it's difficult for the sailors to build a good strategy pre-start, and also hard for them to decide what sail size to use. But Nick, that's almost a second priority. The big story here is we've got six teams out on the water. The boat builders have worked overtime and they've managed to construct a new hull for Tech 2, and the boys are ready to race.
It's an incredible story and a great example of some remarkable teamwork. Luke Parkinson could hardly believe himself.
I think anyone who's been in competitive sport and had to sit out and watch through injury or equipment damage is one of the hardest things, and it's pretty hard emotional to keep it together. But I think our guys have done a pretty decent job of it. You know, we've been watching video footage, staying up late, and working out what everyone else has learnt, trying to catch up. You know, I've definitely got under quite a few people's skin, just pushing and pushing, trying to get it all ready, and probably lost maybe a couple of mates this week. But you know, a couple of drinks and we'll all be good again. And Tyson's bunch, you know, the boat builders have been working around the clock, and you know, today she floats, she works, and we're ready to go racing. You know, we're recharged, we're ready to go, and we're just waiting for the breeze.
Luke Parkinson there, probably the happiest man in Geelong to be making the start line. It really was an around-the-clock scramble after such an eventful first race weekend in Adelaide. Let's take a look at the highlights.
The premier race day in the breakthrough Superfoiler circuit was spiced with suspense. A delayed start due to heavy wind and frightening flight time once the skirmish was ignited. For Euroflex, it was the opening Nathan Outeridge, Ian Jensen and Glenn Ashby had been dreaming of.
So puffy and tricky. Lots of trim required and lots of foil adjustment, but everyone said we made it look easy, but it didn't feel easy on board.
Adelaide dazzled for day two, and you couldn't have scripted a better finish between Paul Campbell-James's ID and Steve Thomas's pavement.
The water, an amazingly close finish there. I can't believe it. 2 seconds.
Nice, boys. Good finish.
Things took a dive for CJ, who became more acquainted with Outer Harbour than he would have liked.
We've lost someone overboard there. In fact, I can't see who it is yet, but they were going so fast.
We read an article last night about some shark attack off the coast recently, real close to here, and that's the first thing that goes through my head.
There we go, jump back on, and look, they're back in the game, they're back in the race. That was pretty awesome, pretty quick.
Hostilities clipped up a gear for the Sunday session.
Wow, hold your nerve. ID crosses ahead of Euroflex.
Clean Maid's Olivia Price showing her ticker.
Me pavement, tacked.
Water, go.
I can't.
Water, go.
There's a f***ing boat there too.
They got to give way to us.
ID's Big Three proving they wouldn't be bullied by any machine, especially Euroflex.
And CJ's doing it again. The guy's gone mad.
Three, two, one.
though ultimately their runway wasn't long enough.
Yeah, ID has put Euroflex on notice that it's not going to be clean air in Victoria.
Nice work, lads.
The Blue Bolter with a seventh win from as many outings.
The challenge was thrown down. They've raised the bar and shown they've got the strength. They've Euroflexed it. It's a clean sweep.
CJ and his boys are obviously been getting better and better every race and pushed us the whole way around. And even on the last run, you know, it was still anyone could have taken that one.
A perfect start to the opening regatta.
Taking a look at the series leaderboard after round one in Adelaide, Euroflex on six. ID Intranet, the next best. Tessa Parkinson, no real surprises that Euroflex was so dominant.
Yeah, Nick, look, they've won every race in the competition so far. And the three sailors, they're renowned to be the best in the world. Nathan, Glenn and Goobs. And in particular, Nathan and Goobs have spent more than 10 years campaigning together in the 49er. So they've got solid teamwork skills, which are really helping their boat speed.
Absolutely, they sure do. And that means the rest of the fleet are looking to scheme to find a way to unlock that dominance. Let's find out what they've come up with.
Practice, I think, is the big secret to catching Euroflex. You know, we were out for a good day yesterday. We finished it with a little swim. But, you know, even that is all good practice. You know, we've got to perform well today. And, you know, there's Tech Tour back out on the water today, and there'll be a good challenge to them as well.
They really are three of the best foiling sailors in the world. So they're really experienced and they're really polished. So I think that's something that we really need to take into the next few events so that by Sydney we can take them down.
I think it's us versus them, isn't it? And then, yeah, with that attitude, I think it's 5-on-1.
Is there some chat around the launch pad at the moment that you guys need to start ganging up on them a little bit?
I think there might have been something said at dinner last night, but we might just keep that between ourselves and we'll see how it goes.
We've seen all their secrets. Well, not all of them, but quite a few. You know, I've sailed with Nathan Goobs quite a lot, so I think I've got a similar way of thinking with the foils and things like that. But also, you know, our boys, we're not afraid to keep the foot down on the pedal. So, and we've shown that before, so we just got to manage that a little bit and then we'll see how we go.
Heard of a meeting of the minds last night. A couple of the teams got together, formulated a battle plan to single objective, take Euroflex down. Gosh, that mustn't feel too good.
Yeah, look, I'm sure we've got targets on our backs now after, you know, having a little win last weekend in Adelaide. But at the end of the day, you know, you're racing yourself on these boats as much as you're racing your opponents. It's very, very difficult to get these boats around the track cleanly. You can't hide on these things. You know, you make a mistake, you get exposed. And that's the beauty about the high-performance racing is that you've got to be on your game 100% of the time. The gains and losses can be quick. And, you know, hopefully we can have another successful event here.
Glenn Ashby with a target on his back and at his home regatta. The pressure starting to build for him. He'll be absolutely relishing that. Tess, we've got a wider race course this weekend. Do you think that'll bring the racing closer together?
Yeah, look, different conditions here and all the teams have had more time in the boat. We had three races yesterday. We saw some really close finishes and the time distance between all the boats was much closer. So I think we're going to be in for some pretty exciting racing today.
Absolutely, and there was plenty of exciting racing yesterday as well. Let's find out how it all unfolded.
Stop two of the circuit and Geelong's wider runways had Phil Robertson licking his lips.
Fast out here, good one.
Euroflex again dropped the hammer while Tech 2's skipper slipped up.
Tack!
After victory in the Victorian opener, Euroflex searched for spectacular in the next, threading the needle, en route to another win, and starting to look unstoppable, the Dream Team on cloud nine. But Record Point wasn't going to have any of that.
Hey!
He's not lying.
The dark horse galloping towards a breakthrough victory until Euroflex robbed the Kiwi crew of glory, this time with the line in spitting distance.
Yeah, boys! We got him!
You're good, hey. That's the schnitzel.
Oh, painful. Oh, that would have been a good one to get up.
Sort of feel almost a bit sorry for him there to pip him on the line right at the end, but we're like, nah, we can't give it away that easy, so we... you know, we actually pulled off a really nice jibe and you know, managed to just sneak through by a boat length at the end. So super exciting and you know, definitely got the old heart rate above 50 beats per minute,
all
that's
good,
for sure.
Lads. Nice race, mate.
Yeah.
Solid day,
boys. Yeah, it was actually pretty painful, to be honest. We just didn't quite have enough heat in the oven at the end of that race. Painful finish to be drifting so close to a win, but now we're coming for them, and I think the blue boat will go down soon.
Absolutely no doubt about it. Phil Robertson's team, the story from our opening day here, of course, record point, doing really well. Three top three finishes, and in the last race, almost squeezed out Euroflex, who again have shown they really are the front marker. Tess Parkinson joining me. What a day it was, and what a day we have lined up for us today.
Yeah, we're in for a tricky day, I think, with these frontal conditions we've got and really variable. We've seen different sail sizes between the teams, so I'm looking forward for the racing to get underway.
I think we all are, and one man who is particularly enthused is joining us right now, James Wabowski. Massive result for your team. Really, really happy to see Record Point do so well.
Yeah, it was awesome to see Phil do so well yesterday on Record Point. He's got some solid guys around him now and a little bit of racetrack to just put the foot down and let it rip.
Yeah, no doubt about that. And someone who's going to give us an insight into just how tricky those conditions are is Jack McCartney. Jack is on the water right now.
Thanks, Nick. Great to be out on the waters in Geelong, Australia for the second ever Superfoiler Grand Prix event. We've got some tricky conditions at the moment. I would say it's a transitional wind. So it's in the northeast at the moment, but we are expecting it to flick left into the northwest and even west a little bit later on. So what we're seeing is big patches of no wind and patches of lots of wind at the moment. A lot of the boats have been choosing the big mainsail, and some have had their little mainsails up expecting more wind. Having looked at Euroflex over my shoulder here, they've just pulled their little mainsail down and put their big one up. So it seems everyone's got the same gear up, and we can expect some fierce battles out there today.
So, Jack, how much wind have you got on the water at the moment for their start?
Tess, we've got about 0 knots at the moment, but I can expect about 8 to 10 very shortly. So we're in about 2 minutes before we get into a sequence, but not a lot at the moment, but it's coming.
Well, that's very good, Jack, because you do look very comfortable down there, so just as well you're not getting blown off that rib.
Very comfy down here, Nick. You should be down here with a cold one with me.
Now, Jack, can you just run us through what course they're sailing for the first race today?
Sure, Tess. So the course will be a two-lap course. So they'll start through the start-finish gate behind me. They'll go up to the top marks, bear away and go flat stick back through the gate, the start-finish gate, down to the bottom marks, back up to the top mark, and then back through the finish. So it's a two-lap course, up, down, up, down.
Jack McCartney, a.k.a. Jack Sparrow down there pirating on the water. Surely, as we look at Record Point, Jimmy, you were mentioning some interesting insight about the sail setup, because you can change one of the sails, but you can't, once you're sticking with the main, you're locked in for the rest of the day.
Yeah, exactly. So the crews, I was hanging out with them all before they went out, and there was a lot of chat, people sort of G-ing each other up to try something new, but I think everyone's picked their big main to start off with, and as you said, once they start with that, they have to keep that all day, and those jibs, that sail up the front, that's the sail that they have the freedom to change as the breeze increases. So there's a lot of them a little bit nervous today, I'd say, expecting big things from the Victorian weather system this afternoon, but they'll have to keep it all together, and looks like, yeah, they've got almost no wind at the moment, but it's just a lot of rain around, just sucking a lot of the wind up, and I'm sure within minutes it'll pump back in.
Yeah, 90 seconds away from go time here, and what a sight that is. Tech 2, they really had their backs to the wall. Many would have thought this regatta was well and truly out of reach, but an incredible work from the back room team just to get those guys on the water. A bit of a terrible day for them yesterday. Luke Parkinson went for a swim, and they finished dead honking last in all the races. Something's got to change today, Tess.
Yeah, look, they've got Sam Newton on the bow today, so they've done a crew change, so they're back to their regular team. And I think they're in pretty good spirits. You know, it's not easy coming back on the water after, you know, having all that time off when a lot of the other teams have been training. So I think, you know, they would have regrouped, and I think they're pretty happy. They look pretty relaxed here setting up for the start.
They sure do. There's Sam absolutely laying down there, and he's obviously got news that this race will be postponed due to a lack of weather. So they were sort of bracing themselves for a big gust, something nice and scary to start things racing today, Jimmy, but we've just had word that, in fact, it will be postponed.
Yeah, so as Jack said, the Euroflex guys, as you see in picture here, they were actually sailing around on their small main. I was talking to Glenn Ashby before, and he was pretty confident that it was going to be a small main, small jib day, and the breeze was in at the time, but with this rain system hanging around, it's obviously sucking all that wind away very quickly, and it will just pump back in. So you can see there a lot of blue sky. That's a good sign down the coast.
Right, yeah.
It is meant to be a hot day this afternoon, so you see that sun come out. It'll allow that mixing of the air, and we'll have that breeze pump in no time.
Tess, as an Olympic sailor, you know all about this start sequence. How frustrating is it? You've psyched yourself up. You've listened to all the epic rock anthems before you head out on the water, and then all of a sudden it's all on ice, and you're not sure when the next one's going to drop.
We are racing, yeah.
Nick, it's one of the variables that comes with the sport, and you know, after doing so many races, you get very used to waiting, and you know, changes with the weather can happen so quickly. And I think it's a good sign that it's really calm out there at the moment, because there's nothing that the wind's got to sort of push out of the way to be able to come in, and we are expecting a shift around to the left. So I don't think we're far off this new breeze filling in. And like James has pointed out, we were hearing, you know, there was a bit of nerve with the sailors before they launched, and you know, if the wind comes in, you don't want to be caught out having the big sails on, because the boats will just be way too powerful, you know. And they transition.
What do you reckon of these clouds out here, boys?
Sending it and going really, really fast to, you know, at about 16 knots, transitioning into survival mode.
Well, we just saw a shot of the hospitality craft there, and I can tell you they won't be postponing anything. They'll be howling along at full gas in there already. And here's a man that had so much success, Phil Robertson. Let's find out what's going on.
I'll tell you what it feels like. It feels like going to Hobart.
Yeah, you can see the guys there just having a bit of a laugh, just chatting about what might happen, but I think they're just trying to keep their nerves all under control. They've got a new team member on there today, or for this event and the rest of the series. A local guy from Sorrento, Sam Phillips, jumping in the main sheet there. So he's only sailed the boat for 2 days now. He only got 1 day of training before yesterday's racing, and he is right at home in that position.
Let me into the mind of this man on screen, Phil Robertson. He's always got a smile on the dial. He's had such a hard run in that first weekend in Adelaide, as we mentioned. And yesterday, he did what so many of us would expect from the world match racing champion, and he just roared back into life. And I know Jack McCartney will probably have something to say about that. Jack, give us the latest from the water's edge, please.
The latest out here, I'm baking in the sun with no wind, so we're anxiously awaiting the breeze to fill in from any direction. So if you look behind me, I've got the boats just sitting idle, cooling their heels. At the moment, the breeze is a little bit in the northeast, maybe 4 knots just coming through. All the spectator boats lined up at the top marks, so I think in the next 10 minutes we'll see something coming through, Nick.
And Jack, have we got any rain from our pictures? It looks like the sea state's sort of flicking up and down. Are there any raindrops?
No rain at the moment. I had the rain jacket on a little bit earlier, but I think that was premature. So, yeah, what happens later in the day.
Hey, Jack, can you just fill us in what's happening on board pavement? We've just got a close-up of them at the moment, and we can see are they doing a jib change or having problems getting the jib halyard to engage?
Looks like they're just doing a jib change. So they may have had the little jib on, and definitely is the big jib for the call at the moment. So they're probably, just going to put that up in a minute and get ready for a start.
Okay, Jack, and Euroflex is the only team with the small main. Have we got that correct?
No, they had the little main up earlier. I think they were doing some testing and expecting a little bit more wind to fill in, but they've changed their mind, so they've got the big gear up. And the other boat that had it was the Clean Mate sitting over here behind me. And they've also made the change as well, I think. So everyone's on the big gear.
Okay.
And as you know, Tess, big gear wins.
Yeah, big sails win big races. Thanks, Jack.
All the gear and no idea down there for Jacko. Big gear, loving that. Well, thankfully, the good thing about Geelong as a region is there is plenty to do when you can't go sailboat racing. And we sent CJ down there to find out some of the delights of the local waterways.
Chuck it over the line, in between the boys. On the way back in, let's go. Pulling up some muscles. I don't really know how we do it yet,
but we'll find out in a minute.
So could you just crack that open and eat that? If you guys can't do it.
I'm not massive on seafood.
That's quite good.
Geelong seems a really, really nice spot. Yeah, looking forward to kind of touring around a bit more. It's really easy when you come to a sailing event just to stay within this 1 kilometre block between the hotel and the sailing club, and it's really important to go out and get as much viewing as possible.
And your daughter Summer, she's 2 years old. How hard's it been being away from her?
Being away from Helen, my wife, and Summer, my daughter, is the hardest bit of coming out here, but you know, they understand. You know, Summer's been picking up loads of new words, and she was saying, hurry up, daddy, to me on the phone yesterday, which I thought was hilarious because I've never heard her say that before. And
saying hurry up, daddy, was that on the race course? She's not happy with your speed?
No, I don't think she quite understands that much, but yeah, she'll be shouting that in a few years' time when she's watching the racing, I'm sure.
Have you been surprised by the amount of support? You seem to be adopted as the second team almost. Everyone can see how close you are to knocking the Euroflex guys off their perch. That must be a nice feeling.
Yeah, it is a nice feeling. I kind of was thinking it was going to be exactly the opposite way around, and we were going to be the kind of the villains that, you know, I was trying to make as many analogies with the rugby teams and cricket teams, but actually it's been totally the opposite, and everyone's really been really supportive, which has been really good.
Paul Campbell-James, the skipper of ID there, and like a lot of these high-performance athletes, not a sailor that really likes going offshore, which I found surprising. Jimmy, are there a lot of top-flight sailors on our roster here who aren't a big fan of heading too far offshore?
Yeah, for sure there is. A lot of us do like to get in a hotel bedroom at the end of the day and have a nice meal. But, you know, you've got guys like Luke Parkinson, who's won the Volvo Ocean Race, and, you know, you've got some sailors that have never been offshore. A lot of the Australian sailors might dip their toe in the Sydney to Hobart, which is definitely one of the tougher races. But, yeah, it's not for everyone, that's for sure.
No, thankfully, the delicious food of the Bellarine is something for everyone, and I know CJ was saying he can't wait to bring his family back down. As we look at pictures from on board ID, Fang, they're trying to keep himself busy or at least entertained before he goes for another recline test.
Yeah, now Nick, the good thing about these boats, they're really widespread and you can see the trampoline and you can just sink the hulls in the water when you're not flying. Look, they've just got a little bit of pressure there. See that windward hull just lift above the water and rise? But look, they're nice boats just to be able to sit and sort of switch off and just chill out. So I don't think the sailors would mind being out on the water there at all.
No, it's probably nice for them to get a breather because they've been going so hard during these races. That was a really interesting takeaway from the Adelaide Regatta, was just how difficult and taxing it is on these machines, Jimmy.
Yeah, absolutely. Once you start throwing a lot of manoeuvres, you're going to wear down the energy that's available on the boat. Things start to happen slower and poor decisions happen and mistakes get made. So here we've got a bit more of an open racetrack and people will for sure be able to minimise manoeuvres. And you just saw in the top of the shot there a lot of white caps. I've just had some observations from around the place, anywhere from 5 to 25, 30 knots around. So it's very stormy, very variable, and hopefully we can knock off a race here and we'll have some good action for sure.
I know Clean Mate in particular would be really fingers crossed for them that there is some racing because Olivia Price, the skipper, has a fair few family members who are at the water's edge here in Geelong. And I know indeed that Glenn Ashby on board Euroflex, this is a massive regatta for him. It's a home regatta. He's racing back on home shores for the first time in so long. Tessa, you've done a lot of racing around Australia. You're from Perth. How nice is it to race at a home regatta?
Oh, look, you realise as well when you do a lot of travelling and sailing at these different regattas overseas just how good we've got it in Australia. You know, this water space out here in Melbourne, you can see the wind's just come in a little bit now. Flat water out on the race course as well, which is ideal for these boats to be able to get up on the foils and to maintain stable flight once they're up and tracking. And we've got more of an open course here than what we had in Adelaide, so a bit more distance should allow the teams to accelerate the boats and reach higher top speeds.
And Jimmy, you're a Victorian. This was going to be your home regatta, so you'll be really well placed to give us an idea of just how nice it is to have the chance to race in front of your family and friends.
Yeah, it's a little tough sitting here watching the racing from the shoreline, but yeah, it is awesome to come home. Two guys from Victoria, Sam Phillips, you can see there in the middle of record point there, and Glenn Ashby, just from the other side of Port Phillip Bay here, and they'll be loving the opportunity to race in front of their fans.
And Corio Bay, it is a nice course. I know a lot of the sailors were saying they were looking forward to it. Aside from wind lows, what can we usually expect from it?
Yeah, look, this is somewhat a typical sort of day around that summertime sort of period where it is very stormy. We get these big storms out of Bass Strait that can hit in no time, and often they're unpredictable. We don't always know how hard they're going to hit. A lot of the sailors know that, and they'll be in the back of their mind for sure.
Well, you can see the breezes filled in. There was enough wind for all three to be trapping there, accelerating the boats. So we'll just listen on board and see what their thought process is, just setting up for this next race. Riding.
Give the main a pump.
A little bit difficult to hear what's going on there, but it looks like they're really trying to spot the pressure up the course and build a pre-start strategy. It's going to be difficult, James, in these conditions to know where to go on the course and to have a solid plan going into the start. They might need to be more open-minded and just watch where the kind of unpredictable pressure lanes are at the time, and just the more pressure, the faster you go. It's that simple, isn't it?
Yeah, we're very lucky here to have the pictures that we do. I bet you the guys on the boat wish they could tune into the live stream, because you know, we get the aerial view, we get the shot from the helicopter, and we can see the breeze better than they can. So it may look easy to us sometimes, thinking, oh, why are you going that way? You should be going the other way. But there's your shot from on the water. It's very difficult to see. And that aerial view just gives you that perfect picture of the race course. And you can see these guys are three strings, low hooks, and they're fully powered up now.
Now, we spoke about trapezing earlier, James. You know, your feet, when you're out on the wire there, are your main point of contact with the boat, and you get a lot of feel out of your feet from how the boat's pitching and tipping, and you've really got to commit, you know, your weight out in that harness to feel like you've got control of the boat.
Yeah, for sure. A typical boat, we're used to it just leaning over one way and coming back upright. But these boats, as you said, we're on trapeze. Only way we're connected to the boat really is through our feet, and the boat can roll on top of you, away from you, the bow can go up and down. So it's really this new four-dimensional sort of feeling on the foils, on trapeze. So much going on, and it just raises the risk factors for sure.
I know when I had a go on board in the main sheet and we got up to sort of 34 knots, I was super scared and just holding on to the Sam's harness in front of me. But you can see the close-up of their trap ropes as well. You can adjust yourself up and down on the wire depending on how much wind you've got, but you can see there they're flat trapping. They're quite low on the wire. The skipper typically needs to be a little bit higher so they can see over their crew.
Yeah, it's like being in a go-kart, you know, you're so close to the water. As you can see, like, a little bit of the wrong heel and you're just going to get wiped off the boat at, you know, 30, 35 knots. We're going to see some big speeds today for sure. And you can see they're just getting rocked around on the wire. CJ really leaning on Fang. They're going to widen their stance. They've got these foot straps on the boat which they can connect into. And they're really just trying to hold on.
And is this a case of keeping themselves warm, or are they trying to adjust to the breeze, get a feel for where it's coming, so that when it is eventually go time, they're really across it? Is that what it is? Because it's quite actually cold out there at the moment.
Yeah, look, these guys are going to be frantic right now. We haven't done much sailing this pressure, and they're quickly going to be trying to go upwind, downwind, find their settings. If they trim the boards to the wrong angle, the boat will just completely flip over before they even know it. So right now they're getting these big puffs of wind, and they're just quickly going to go sailing as fast as they can, find their numbers, dial everything in, and that's going to help them not make those mistakes when they turn the top mark for the first time.
Now, I think one of the big factors that's in their favour on board ID Intranet, Ed and Fang, the bowman and the main sheet, they're super fit guys. They've both played a lot of rugby and spend a lot of time in the gym and are really fit. And if this breeze does come in and three races, I think that's going to really help them a lot.
Just talking about Ed Powie's fitness, actually, we've got a stat from Dexter, who have done a body scan of all the athletes, and he'll be very happy for me to say this on air. His body fat percentage is very low compared to those of the same age and gender, so he is in peak physical condition. And we can have a look at the Cineflex there. That's Adam, our amigo in the skies. He's got his hand up. He's having a great time. Best seat in the house, Adam. He's loving it.
Yeah, look, that's not a bad spot to be in. You can see all the teams starting to freak out a little bit. Okay, we've got to get the jib down, get the main down, get the small gear up. They're getting hit with some pretty big gusts now, and yeah, they're going to be trying to quickly change and adjust this sail combo to make sure they can get it around the top mark.
That's really interesting. So had they have started racing in the first race and their main was up, they would have been locked in for the rest of the racing today, but they've almost got a bit of reprieve. The ominous clouds give them a chance to reset and, I guess, play it a little safer.
Yeah, Nick, look, I've just got some information from Hayley, who's out on the start boat, and they're trying to move the course around at the moment. The wind has gone left, and they've just seen a gust of 25 knots out there. So this new pressure is definitely filled in over the course.
We're in the eye of the storm.
Yeah, absolutely. It's going to be really unstable for the next little bit, and then it will settle and we'll get some racing away. But maybe Jack down on the water can give us a little better update.
Thanks, Jimmy. Yeah, a bit of action happening down here. The breeze has filled in from the northwest. We've got gusts of 25, and it's meant to be settling down to 20. So at the moment, we're above our wind limit. I can see the prefrontal cloud coming through, so we're hoping that that's going to pass and the breeze will settle down a little bit and we'll get into some racing. But we're seeing all the boats pull all their big gear down and getting their little sails back up. So heading over to the ID ship to help them with some sails.
Very good, Jack McCartney. Don't you worry about changing your gear. You look like you're absolutely under control at the moment. Look, Phil Robertson's even laughing at that joke of mine. Things are looking up. So we've just gone from not enough wind to potentially too much. Things can change in the blink of an eye here in Victoria.
Yeah, we've been geeing a lot of the guys up that we do have Bass Strait just over the corner there, and they know how ominous that stretch of water is and how fast these frontal systems hit. So we've been trying to freak them out a little bit, like get everyone off their game a bit, but that'll all be under control, and if the race officer says go, then everyone's going to be keen to go.
These teams operate with military precision. They're so well drilled, as we can see from our pictures, that as you predicted, Tess, they are altering the course. But it's so interesting to see that these well-drilled units, these SWAT teams of the seas almost, a bit of nerves are starting to creep in. A few shaky hands as they were fiddling around with that jib. So as you say, Jimmy, I guess the nerves really are coming into play as the wind's picking up, Tess.
Yeah, look, mentally you've got to be, you know, pretty alert and ready for anything and open-minded when you're sailing. You know, just 5 minutes ago we were sitting in hardly any wind, and now, as Jack said, this is above the wind limit for these boats to sail. So, you know, very, very quickly you've got to be able to change your decision-making process, change your strategy, change your feel in the boat. But we just saw the mark layers before. Nick, they've got a really key job out here on the race course, because the sailors all want to sail an upwind course for that first leg, so it's pretty cool that the top marks directly into the wind direction. So we've had a 30-40 degree wind shift, so that's quite a significant change of the course marks.
It really does shuffle the deck up here, no doubt about that, Tess, as we see Nathan and the boys just shifting their strategy at the moment, and probably enjoying a chance to just take a breather as our hospitality boat, there's a few hands up there, a few people ready for the racing to kick off. We all are ready. We can't wait for that race to get going when it does, but we of course have to make sure it is done so in very safe conditions.
Yeah, look, each of the teams out there have their own support boat, and you can see as we get this overshot, Tech 2 here, they've got their boatman or safety boat just alongside here. So they play a really key role, especially when they're changing sails and fixing gear on the boat and regrouping and stopping in between races like this. So they've got a coaching role plus maintenance on the boat, and they assist a lot in sail changes. So you can see the rib ties up alongside that windward hull of the boat, and they can hang on there and keep the extra sails that the teams aren't going to use inside their boat.
Yeah, it's a real advantage, no doubt about that. And that shot of the spectator before just reminded me of how lucky we are to be able to get so close to the racing here. It's free. All you have to do is pop out on the harbour and see the Formula One machines of our sport zoom along, usually zoom along. For now, they're just in a holding pattern. They will take off soon enough as we see the spectator craft getting really close to some seriously impressive technology.
Yeah, it looks like on board Tech 2 they're doing something with the bottom batten. So these mainsails, they're full batten sails. You can see they're quite hard to see actually in the lines, but there are full battens. There's probably about eight of them up the main, which help them hold shape. And as it gets windier, you really want to tighten that batten tension to try and flatten out the sail. So it looks like they might be. They've taken one of the battens out and got it on board the deck here, whether they're trying to get the halyard lock to work at the top. Maybe, James, you can explain how this locking system works to hold the sails up.
Yeah, it's quite similar to a lot of the traditional catamaran halyard lock systems that we know, with that wing-shaped mast that sort of molds to that shape of the sail as well. And the odd thing about these mainsails is that they do go all the way down to the deck, which is quite uncommon. A lot of people that have ever been on a sailboat would know that the boom and you sort of go underneath the sail out to the other side. But this deck sweeper sail is really revolutionary stuff. What it creates is this sort of end plate effect to the trampoline. So that trampoline's a solid surface, and when they're sailing upwind or downwind, that sail will connect to that trampoline, and it just increases efficiency by 10 or 15%. So it's a really revolutionary sort of thing on these boats. It makes it more difficult to handle. You can see that little gap through the back between the tiller bar and the sail. That's where they have to try and squeeze through and attack or a jibe. But yeah, the efficiency gain in that is really revolutionary and quite impressive.
Gosh, there's not much gap there. It's like a Euroflex mop just sweeping the ground. And it does look pretty wet on the trap at the moment. It's pretty... I guess immersive down there on.
Yeah, there's quite a bit of chop building. It's still an offshore breeze, but as you said, a lot of spectator boats creating a lot of wash, and that'll be something difficult that they'll have to deal with when they're racing. We really do like the flat water and stable wind conditions on these boats, especially with the limited training that everyone's had, but they're really thrown in the deep end right now. You can see there the waves sort of crashing over the boat and how mixed up it is. It's incredibly tough conditions to race in at the moment.
Aidan Menzies, who's just towards the stern of the boat there, I was having a chat to him, obviously saying, gosh, you must be so disappointed that you guys weren't able to score any points from Adelaide or lost a lot of chance to accumulate points. He said, you know what, mate, that's not the thing I'm worried about. The thing I'm actually worried about is the time we lose on board the machine, on board the Superfoiler, having a chance to actually finesse, practice, drill up the routine and get skill. And I found that really interesting.
Yeah, they're such a new boat, Nick, and it's a brand new design. This is only the second regatta of the Grand Prix series, and the teams didn't have a lot of training time leading into it. And I think, as we see race after race unfold, each of the teams is just working out a slightly better technique or way of doing something on the boat, and they're all becoming more comfortable. So I think initially in this race series we'll see an exponential increase in how good the teams are on the boats, and to miss out on that first sort of foot jump of training time is difficult. But like Luke said earlier, they've been watching a lot of video and studying what a lot of the other teams are doing, so hopefully they can just learn by watching off the others and then put those things into place pretty quickly.
Yeah, and I know that Glenn Ashby's on board. I mentioned already his friends and family are out here. His wife Mel will be really having her fingers crossed that the racing does kick off soon, because she's probably brought a whole lot of friends across to watch an America's Cup conqueror take on the waters of Victoria. And at the moment, we can see Goobs there's already making himself home at the rib. He's already got his hands on the wheel there, and they don't look like they're in too much of a rush to get back on there.
They're going to be better with
this big discussion always on the sail choice, and obviously you can see right there how windy it is. But as happened before, this wind can die. So they're going to get a call from the race office to say, all right, we're going in 5 or 10 minutes. And then they go, right, this is the sails we're going to choose. Because that mainsail choice, that defines your day. You can't change that once they start race one. So they need to nail that choice.
Well, how about that to give you an indication of how much the breeze is starting to howl in at the moment. These guys better get ready, because something big is coming. And preparation is half of anything in sailing, Tessa.
Yeah, you can see there's some waves out there as well. There's a wind chop that's built in pretty quickly. So that's going to make for difficult sailing conditions. There's a lot of white caps out there. It looks to me like it's too windy at the moment. It looks generally, you can see these white caps when the wind's over 20 knots. And I can see there Euroflex doesn't look like they're in any hurry to pull up their new sails. They're just sitting next to their chase rib, just waiting, probably just monitoring the conditions. We can see on the start boat, the red and white flag there is the postponement flag. So this race, they're just holding and holding and monitoring the wind strength, because they've got to make sure it's within the wind limit. Otherwise, it's just total survival mode for these fast boats. And they're just probably too difficult to manage over 22 knots, Nick.
And that's Richard, our race director, in the super cool hat there on board the Peter Jackson. No relation to the famous Hollywood director, I can say. But Richard would just be having a chinwag, sussing it out, making sure that safety is front of mind before things get underway. But, of course, the imperative is safety. But all of these guys, all of the spectators, all of the sailors, they really, really just crave being able to go out and race.
Yeah, absolutely. It's really interesting. When you start a race and the wind builds, it doesn't even enter your mind. You're just in full race mode. Your focus is just so sharp. And when you get these little delays and you know it's windy and you know that they might start a race at any time, that's when the nerves start to build up. And do not think for a minute that these sailors aren't getting nervous. I can guarantee you everyone out there is getting really on the edge of their seat and a little bit worried about what they might have to try and pull off here. But it's going to be an awesome race when they get this underway. And yeah, it'll be interesting to see who deals with those nerves best and who can keep it all under control.
I know you've got a cool hand, Jimmy, of course. You're a very relaxed customer. Quick update on your injury as well. I know we weren't quite sure in Adelaide, just the extent of it.
Yeah, no, look, it's all good. I'm going to be on the sidelines joining you guys for a couple more weeks, but it'll heal up, no problem.
And what level of tear do you have there as well?
Yeah, grade 2 tear, so a little more than a strain, but it's all still in one piece. So good news there, and I'll just make sure I'm 100% ready. You know, you don't want to jump on these boats a little premature at all. Let me get the banners to the other side. I'll be good for heaps, no time.
That's great news. And I know you are being modest because our race doctor was probably listening there. You told me it was 95% ligament tear. Is that true?
Yeah, look, the MRI was not too bad, but I heal quick. I'm good. I'm going
to
be fine.
You absolutely do. Yeah. And I guess your loss is our gain, Jimmy. We're so glad to have you here, adding your expert insight. And I'm feeling a little left out at the moment because I know you've had a lot of time on the Superfoiler. And Tessa, you've been out there as well. And I haven't been yet. No one's letting me near these things.
Oh, you're going to have to talk to one of the sailors and get on board for a ride, Nick, because I can tell you it's just... Oh, I've never felt anything like being on board the boat, like trapezing and doing 34 knots. It's the most, you feel like you're flying above the air. You're really gliding through the, but you can, I guess, you know, having sailed so much, I was just I felt a bit out of control because I'm used to steering on the 49er. So being on the main sheet has sort of had all trust in my brother at the helm, and I was just hanging out there and, that you can feel the pitch of the boat's really sensitive, so the bow down and the bow back, and it, you know, you can hear the boys call on board, you know, big puff coming on in 3, 2, and you can see the sink where everyone's got to be ready for that pressure to hit the boat, for the boat to bear away, and the mainsail trimmer to really respond accurately. Otherwise, the bow digs in, and it's quite scary, really.
All the muscles tense up, I'm sure about that. And it looks like ID Intranet's one of the last to be bringing down their main. Would there have been any chance there, Jimmy, that they were looking to just go a completely other strategy, or were they just taking their time?
Yeah, look, everyone's sort of been getting stuck into each other, you know. Everyone's saying big sails with big races, and it's kind of like who dares wins here at the moment. So people are trying to G each other up to, you know, really take it on. You know, if you do put the big sails up, you're going to have more horsepower. And, you know, sometimes you got to risk it a little bit, but we'll just see who's going to take the conservative approach here.
It's always a trade-off in sailing, isn't it? You need maximum power to be able to get going, but then once you're going, you just want to decrease drag and flatten it off as much as you can. So you almost want the big sail to reach your top speed, and then you want the small sail to have less drag so you can really, really fly through the water.
That's a great visual of the perks of being a skipper. Look at Fang and Ed Powie's there, absolutely going to work. And CJ's just admiring the spectacle, probably providing some encouragement every now and then, but certainly hardly doing the hard yards there.
Yeah, sometimes the skippers just get their hand glued to the tiller there and you can't peel them off no matter what's happening. But, he'll be just taking it all in and keeping everything under control.
Things are looking pretty nice above the Phoenix. They're probably dialed into the race radio themselves trying to get the update on what's happening. That guy definitely wants to put that long lens to work, that's for sure. But we will stay on our toes to find out exactly when the racing is underway. And look at that, bobbing up and down, relaxing out there.
We're just hearing off from the start boat that we are consistently getting gusts of over 20 knots out on the race course. So I've just heard from the start boat that all of the superfoilers have been instructed just to head back to the marina, and this postponement's going to hold. So we might, Nick, just see what Jack's got to say down on the water.
I think that's a great idea. Jack, can you bring us up to speed, please?
Yeah, guys, plenty of breeze down here. We've had gusts of 30, and it looks pretty settled in at 25 now. So the call has been made to get the boats off the water and onto the dock, which is a safety call first. So we've got to look after the teams first and foremost. So all the sails are down bar ID's jib, so as soon as they're down, then all the boats will be coming in for a standby situation.
And Jack, for those sailors out there at the moment, it's obviously an uncertain wait for them as to whether or not they get back on the water. Have you had any updates from the race director, Richard, about the likelihood of that?
No, I haven't had any updates as yet, but this breeze looks pretty settled in, so... at the moment, I'd say it's doubtful because we are very close to the Southern Ocean here, and the Southern Ocean can be pretty violent. But I'm hopeful, maybe later today, but let's wait and see.
And Jack, you've obviously a Sydney to Hobart veteran yourself. You're used to Bass Strait bouncing up and down. Is it as hard on that boat as it was on Ragamuffin the year you knocked me off?
No, it's not even close. But, you know, this on the Superfoiler, every knot that the breeze goes up, the terrifying nature of the boat goes up. So in 20 knots of breeze, the boat's forecast to do, well, the velocity projections say that it'll do over 40 knots. So that's pretty extreme. So right now, I think all the sailors would be pretty pleased to be heading for the shore.
Jack, do you know what the max speed is that the boats have reached so far? Do you know who holds that record and what it is by any chance?
Well, I had a quiet chat to Glenn Ashby a couple of weeks ago during a very windy nor'easter on Sydney Harbour, and they were broad reaching from Shark Island down towards the Sydney Harbour Bridge, and he said that they were touching 40. So that's probably the speed record at the moment. We've seen a couple of times 36, 37, but that's really fast. And if you're hanging off a trapeze, it's pretty precarious, and you know, you've got to have a real strong nerve to be out there.
Yeah, wow. Do you think that the small mains, because this is the first regatta that they've got that small main, do you think that'll allow when it's windy to reach an even higher speed?
Yeah, you're spot on, Tess. So the smaller gear means more efficiency, less drag. So although it makes the loads on the boat less, it means that the boat goes faster, but it's easier to control, theoretically. So I think there's still a wind limit, and we're looking at 20 knots at the moment. So with the little gear on, they'd be really ripping.
Yeah, wow, I think that's just such a great move to have the two sail options. Makes it, you know, hopefully they can sail in those high wind strengths going forward. But thanks a lot for that update, Jack.
Thanks, Tess.
How good. I mean, look at that sea state at the moment. It looks like a washing machine. Definitely not the right conditions to be fanging these superfoilers at spine-tingling speed, Jimmy.
No, you can see Guy and Dean there, the shore crew for Record Point, just sporting the big yellow life jacket just in case. He's definitely safety first, and he's going to look after the lads real well.
Is that in case he falls over in the bar, or is that for practical measures right now?
He'll have it on for practical measures at the moment, but we'll see later on.
Now, James, just out of what do you reckon around the race course is the, you know, most high-risk area for something to go wrong on the boat? I mean, the top mark when they're bearing away through that max power zone, do you think that's the highest risk area of this racetrack?
Yeah, absolutely. It's incredibly difficult to comprehend how high risk the top mark roundings are. A big problem that they have when they transition from that upwind sailing to downwind, and something that probably looks a little odd for the viewers back home, is that no more sails go up. We're used to going from upwind to downwind, and suddenly you see all these big sails come out, and we need that extra horsepower to go downwind. These boats, they just turn the corner, nothing changes. They ease a little bit of sheet. They do some fancy things with the foils, and they just carry on downwind, and that's purely because they do go so fast. What they're able to do is hold their apparent wind. So if you're stopped at the traffic lights in your car, hold your hand out the window, the wind can be coming from anywhere. And then once you accelerate, that wind will always start coming from straight ahead. That's what these boats are able to do now they go so fast. They turn that corner, and the wind, instead of going from behind them, the wind just stays almost side on, almost on their bow. So that's why they don't have to put up these big spinnakers, and that's why they're able to go so fast. So actually nailing that transition and turning that top mark without a capsize, without falling into windward or another way, is it's really like threading the eye of a needle.
And what about the emotions on board these crafts? We're looking at Tech 2 right now, obviously. Well, look, see, there you go. Things can go wrong pretty quickly. And that certainly doesn't have the same amount of frost. Pretty good re-entry there, I think. Not bad at all.
It's a contender there, so we've got a single-handed boat with a trapeze. I mean, they go pretty quick for their size, and he's probably just out having a bit of a fun sail here on a contender.
Yeah, well, maybe a future contender for the Superfoiler boats if he's brave enough to go out there in these conditions. But I was just going to ask, I mean, for Tech 2, obviously they had an enormous race just to get to the start line. Here they are, and they've been told, no racing for now, guys, let's lower it. How would that be playing out in their heads? They need more time in the boat. They've said they want more time, and they've just been told, hey, guys, sorry, not for now.
Oh, I think, yeah, the anticipation on board here, you just want to wash those nerves off and just get into it. And it's a pretty amazing feeling once that start gun goes. You know, your entire concentration's just on sailing, especially when you're travelling at such fast speeds. Everything you're thinking about is just in the moment and right on board what's happening with the boat. So, you know, when you're waiting around and unsure with postponements and sail changes, your mind doesn't, you know, be able to reach that connection where you're fully into the game.
Jimmy, would there be any relief in some regard for the guys on Tech 2? I mean, surely they would have a tiny bit of uncertainty as to whether or not everything is where it needs to be.
Yeah, look, I can pretty certainly say that Luke Parkinson, the skipper of Tech 2, is probably one of the most nuts sailors I know. As you saw when he managed to just detonate that boat in Adelaide, he just absolutely sends it harder than anyone. I cannot emphasise that enough. Right now, he'll be like, yep, let's go racing, I don't care, let's go. The guys on the front of the boat, I'm not too sure. They're a little more of a passenger. The jockeys up the front, they can just get bucked off at any point. But I know Luke Parkinson knows exactly what he's thinking. He'll want to go racing for sure.
You need a lot of trust in the skipper, don't you? But I think, you know, he has built that trust. But look, I remember even as a little kid, you know, he used to just get his windsurfer and wait for the sea breeze, wait for it to get windy, and then just windsurf all the way to Rotto. So I think, you know, some of these sailors just love the breeze and love just getting out there and giving it everything they've got. It's part of the thrill of racing.
Part of the thrill of racing is, of course, what happens after the racing. And Geelong is such a nice place to dig in and take in some sights as we go high now, getting a look at the skyline. Those big towers over there is the home of the Geelong Cats. It's a great football stadium, a great football culture here, and a great food culture too. There are plenty of nice alleyways to go and wander through. I know we're not in Melbourne, but they've very much got that Melbourne sort of al fresco nightlife vibe. It's a lot of fun to be had here in Geelong. I can certainly vouch for that.
Yeah, Nick, we were pretty lucky this morning. We got to climb to the top of the lighthouse and probably have the best view over the bay from in Geelong at all. So that was a pretty nice little trip up there. We had a great view of the race course and enjoyed watching the other boats out there sailing.
And Olivia Price and her team just going through, striking things down. And yeah, Olivia's, there's a few nicknames within the boat park, or the launch pad, about the boats. And everyone seems to be giving their own boat nicknames. Jimmy, yours was the Dark Horse. Olivia's christened her boat the People's Boat.
Yeah, I have heard that name getting around. And, yeah, they've definitely got a lot of support. The people really do seem to be behind the Cleanmate. And such an impressive performance in Adelaide is... really gone a long way to building their fan base.
No doubt about that, and she's a fantastic sailor. And one of your good friends too, Tess.
Yeah, look, it's obviously being a girl as well in the sport. It's really cool for me to see a girl skipper out here. You know, I think it's important that the sport does support women, and, you know, continually more opportunities are opening up. And, you know, I've got a lot of respect for Olivia. We campaigned together for this last Olympic cycle in the 49er FX, both as skippers. So good at competing against each other, but, you know, I got a lot of respect. She's a lot of fun to race against, so it's just cool to see her sailing and really taking these boats on.
Well, Tessa,
pretty gutsy,
no doubt about that. Tessa, I can't say I've sailed with her or against her, but I can say she's a lot of fun. And while we were in South Australia, we had a chance to catch up and hang out. We'll be right back.
So Olivia, talk me through it. How was your experience here today?
That was incredible. It was like a sensory sensation. I could smell, touch. I got a little bit lost through the stripy, sparkly things, but all in all, it was really cool.
And have you enjoyed your time in Adelaide so far? What have you been up to aside from all the work you've been doing on the boats?
Yeah, so Adelaide's a beautiful city. I've never been here before. So yeah, I was excited to come down. The city is beautiful and the water is amazing. It looks really cool.
And a massive weekend for you this weekend, obviously the start of the series, but also back in competitive sailing after a long time out. How does that feel for you?
Yeah, definitely. I'm really looking forward to getting back into racing, especially the calibre of the fleet that are involved in the Superfoiler. It's such a positive experience to be down here and hanging around with, you know, the world's best sailors.
And you're obviously the boss of your boat, the Clean Maid. Have you gone barking orders so far? How's it been received, do you think?
I think I'm not that bossy, actually. People, Josh in particular, is, yeah, you know, making sure that I'm making the decisions. And Matt Chu on the front for Adelaide, this event is really good in just giving me a bit of confidence and making me back myself. So I think we're going to be a really good team down here and just ready to go racing.
What's Clean Maid actually going for? First race in Adelaide, is it finishing? Is it winning? Is it somewhere in between?
I think this weekend is just a massive learning curve for us. It's going to be interesting to see how everyone races. We haven't raced against each other yet. We've done a couple of lineups. So that's going to be a key thing, is just trying to get around the race course cleanly and make it across the finish line three times each day.
And how tight will the racing be, at least this week in Adelaide? Do you expect everyone will be a bit nicer, give everyone a bit more room, or do you think the teams will want to throw their weight around a little bit already?
I think everyone's here for one reason, and you know, that's to take out the series. So I think that you know, I'm probably the least experienced in foiling sailing, so I think our learning curve is going to be huge. Let's see what this weekend brings, and then bring on the next four.
Olivia, when the racing wraps up this week, you've hopefully had a few good results. Are you planning on checking out any of the wineries in the McLaren Vale or the Barossa while you're here?
Oh, I'd definitely love to come back here. This is an amazing place. Depending on how quickly we can pack our boat away is depending on how quickly I can get down to the wine region and check a few more places out.
Olivia Price there, a wine enthusiast, an Olympic silver medalist, and really, really good company. And I can say that Jack is also pretty good company, and he's in good company. Jack, who have you got for us?
I've got a very casual CJ here. There was a bit on there. There's 30 knots and boats clanging together, but I'm here with Mr. Casual. CJ, did the sphincter tighten a little bit when you saw the breeze come in?
No, we're all right. I was pretty pleased we didn't do that first start in 0 knots of breeze with all the big gear up, but yeah, actually, once we got the main off the lock, it was all pretty casual. We were actually thinking about going with a little foil just with the jib up, but Tyson ruined the day and told us we couldn't.
What would you expect is the most breeze you'd like to go out in?
Well, twice, we haven't done a race in over 15 knots yet. This is still day 7 in the boats, so I think anyone that says they'd be happy in 20 knots would probably be lying. Give us you know, two more regattas and two more days in 18 knots, and you know, it might be a different story. But right now, 20 knots would be quite a push.
How does this all relate to the America's Cup and your experience with the 45s, the 50s, the 72s? Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, you know, it's all the same game. You know, the helm controlling the rake, the boards going up and down is a big deal. Yeah, so it's all the same. It's all the same. It's obviously the trapezing is the big difference. It's a trimaran, so there's a little bit of intricacies about that affect everything. But yeah, it's the same game, and it's the same guys that are winning.
Were the boys fired up to keep sailing? I know Fang would be, but tell us what they were saying when the breeze came through.
Yeah, I thought Fang was going to jump off. He looked so scared. No, the boys were doing a good job, and you know, actually, it's not that easy just to get the sails down in 30 knots. So we did well just to kind of stay chilled and sort everything out and get back to the beach.
Great stuff, CJ. So we're going to dock and get back on land with all the teams. So I'll do a walk around the park and catch up with a few of the other sailors.
Jack, that sounds really good. But before you do that, can you just ask CJ if he's feeling okay after his raw muscle the other day?
How are you? One more question from Nick here. How are you feeling after your raw muscle the other day?
Yeah, I was okay. I was amazed at the actual
the proper muscle, not fishermen, they're farmers more than anything, but those guys wouldn't have any raw muscles, so then they let me have one. So, yeah, no, it was fine. It's good. It's tasty.
We call that being stitched up in Australia. Yeah. Back to you, Nick.
Thank you very much, Jack McCartney, the king of the stitch up there. I'm looking to get him back, and I will one day, that's for sure. We've just heard back that our crafts are heading their way back to the Geelong tie-up point, and that Jack will be doing his level best to chat to a few more sailors, which I'm looking forward to, Tessa. I'm looking forward to hearing from the sailors to discover if they, like Paul Campbell-James, think the right decision has been made today.
Yeah, look, I think all the sailors would be on the same page, and it's great to get their perspective because they're the ones that are, you know, driving these boats and on the water in the different roles. So I'm looking forward to hearing what they've got to say as well. But I thought we could just run through, James, what's required to de-rig these boats and actually get them out of the water at the end of the day. So the foils are very delicate, aren't they? And they've got to be really careful when they're pulling them out with that L shape. So do you want to just run us through what's got to happen on board?
Yeah, absolutely. So as you said, there's some foils that hang down under the boat, and the main ones are those forward ones with the big J or L shape to them, and they're incredibly delicate, as you said. Every team has a shore crew, and 90% of their time will be spent maintaining those foils. So you've basically got to be an artist to work on those foils, because it's all about seeing the curves, seeing the shapes, and making that shape as smooth, as fair as possible. And an amazing amount of time goes into those foils every single night, because the smallest blemish in those foils will mean 5, 10, 15% off your speed. Because at the end of the day, when you're foiling downwind or upwind, that's all that's in the water, and that's where almost all of our drag is coming from. The other part is the rudders, which, not like other traditional boats where the rudder would hang off the back of the boat, you can see there's no rudders in, and that's because they actually slot in a hole under the boat at the back there. And so to push them up the ramp like they are now, they've actually got to take those rudders out whilst they're in the water. It's in deep water. Drop them out and pull them onto the boat. And so they're in that T-shape foil that you'll see getting around. And as CJ alluded to there, as well as trying to get your sails on and off the lock can be quite difficult. And it's like getting caught in a big storm in the Sydney to Hobart. You hope you've changed your sails before it hits. A lot of these guys stuck out there, 30 knots blowing, and they're trying to get their sails down, and it can be an absolute mission. The boat's rocking over all over the place. You're a little bit out of control, and there's a bit of fever on board. So hopefully the teams aren't too rattled, and they're all got a level head now. But with a few of the guys getting their feet back on dry land here, they'll be feeling much happier, I'm sure.
And Dan Morris, with those big arms of his, making it look like it's really hard work pushing the superfoiler pavement up towards the launch pad. But they're only 300 kilos. They're all carbon fibre, super light. And I guess that's why they take off so quickly, Tess.
Yeah, look, it's pretty luxurious actually launching here. It's a beautiful flat beach. They had a massive incline in Adelaide where all the teams had to pitch in and help each other get their boats up the ramp. So, look, this is a lot more civilised. It's quite an easy launching ramp. But you're right, Nick, they're mainly built out of carbon fibre structures, which are extremely strong but also very light. So part of the reason why these boats can go so fast is because they're so light and can get a lot of lift out of the water.
I'm loving this as well. What a rock star Paul Campbell-James is. He's just jumped on the sponsor's boat, and he's going to take the nice way in. This is very Kimi Raikkonen and the Monaco GP when he crashed. He just jumped straight onto a super yacht. Paul Campbell-James has gone, you know what, Ed Powys, you know what, Fang, you boys clean up. I've got an engagement with the sponsors. This skipper stuff is sounding really, really good.
Yeah, we know the roles on the boat. You know, the skipper trims the foils to make the boat fly, and then when they're up on the foils, they're like looking for stable flight. But the mainsheet and the bowman are the two really, you know, physical roles in the boat. The mainsheet, you know, is focusing on the strategy and the shifts, and, you know, a lot of strength required to work that big mainsail that they've got up there. So, Nick, sorry, we're just lifting this boat out of the water here, pulling. You can see they've got the rope attached to the side stay there, and they're aligning the trolley wheels underneath, locking them in underneath the hull, and getting ready to pull it up the ramp.
Yeah, so one of our trusty shore crew there, Brandon, he's got that that life jacket on looking at us now. Yeah, he's going to be making sure the boat's all in one piece. Any work that has to get done, he'll be helping out to make it all get fixed. And it's unusual to see boats not be able to just launch themselves and go sailing, but these boats are so high performance, so high tech. We need shore crews, pit crews, rip drivers, coach boats. It's a full operation to get these things on the water and to make sure that they are in one piece when they go out there and that they can perform as well as they do.
And just like in Formula One, we've got our pit lane and this is where it all happens. And as you said, Brando does a lot of work on those boats. He does a bit of work moonlighting as a Hemsworth brother as well in Little Mallet Street in Geelong. Very busy work. And they put in serious hours on these things, don't they? I mean, we only see 2 hours of racing. Those guys are working for hours and hours on end. And that's not just Tech 2's team. That's every single team.
Yeah, you can't show your skills out on the water if your machine's not set up to be all the control lines working well. And look, the boats look really slick and neat, but actually inside the trampoline, there's a top cover for it, and it goes over the bar in between the mast and the side where the main foil is, and it wraps around underneath. And in between those two cloth pieces of fabric, there's so many control lines controlling their trapezes, the foils, the controls on the sails. So there's a lot of rope work going on, which is very complex underneath there, and the teams need to make sure that it's all set up perfectly, all the ropes are the right length, the shock cords are giving the right amount of stretch. So much time goes into that, and as they're refining their skills and learning more and more, they're continually making more adjustments to make sure each system's working to its optimum.
Yeah, it's really like pulling the bonnet off a car once you get that sealed trampoline off. It's like a spider web of ropes and bungees, pulleys, everything happens under there, and the smallest problem, a little something gets tangled, can absolutely ruin your day. So no room for error in there. And it was interesting in Adelaide, I think we'd been there 2 days and they'd already strung a hammock up in the container for a few of the boat builders to sleep in, because they were going around the clock 24 hours a day working on the foils. There's just so much to be done with these boats to keep them at their top end performance.
Yeah, we saw, James, one of the first things all the teams learned was when they had that capsize and they nosedive, and because you're on trapeze, you just go flying, don't you, around the front. And all the guys were actually snapping their trapeze lines underneath the hull and then, you know, getting the boat upright from a capsize and then not being able to keep sailing because there was no shock cord holding your trap loop into the hull. So they sort of, I think, figured out to rig up a secondary system in between the trapezes there, so that if they do capsize, they can just reattach the new line and still be able to race.
Yeah, absolutely. We've got some of the best water gear that you can possibly have from forward whip. Everything that they're wearing, it does just look like normal wetsuits, but there's shin pads, knee pads, padding all over their bodies. Really strong harnesses, and I've in fact torn two harnesses apart purely because of the loads when the stopper takes up. The forces on your body are unbelievable. You just, things break that have never broken before, and there's this ongoing debate: do we have the stoppers to stop the crew literally flying in front of the boat up as high as the tip of the mast, which in one sense, you know, that is safe if you don't come back and hit anything, but there's a big amount of risk in that. So still a lot of development going on with these boats and how it is to keep your body as safe as it can be on trapeze. But yeah, the refinement in the sailing gear, it's almost like motocross gear now, where we've got full padding all over our bodies and still we're seeing amazing loads being transferred into that.
Yeah, and Ed Powell is having a Titanic moment here. Absolutely, look at that. Jack, hold on to me. He's just playing up for the cameras. He knows exactly where they are. And one heck of a sailor, obviously, in his own right, an America's Cup sailor from BAR. Also, as I mentioned, absolutely no fat on him, just all muscle.
Yeah, Ed Perry, he's an absolute weapon, and he'll be getting on shore and probably checking the surf report, see if he can get down to Bell's Beach or something. He loves his surfing, but he's an absolute machine. There's Fang Warren and all the boys pitching in. Clinton Evans there, one of the riggers. He's going to take care of all the ropes, all the running rigging on the boat. It's amazing how specific all the jobs are in the shore crew to keep these things moving.
Very political of you to say everyone was pitching in. I haven't seen CJ. He's either on the rib, he's commandeered it, and he's heading for more sea mussels, or he's in the bar entertaining sponsors as everyone else gets to work there. But it is. I mean, this is really nice because we don't often get to see the amount of teamwork that goes on behind the scenes. We see three supremely talented sailors at the peak of their powers, but today we get a really good idea of just the level of work that goes into getting these machines in and out of the water. And I know on occasion Jack McCartney does even help out with this, but right now he's not doing that. Jack, what are you up to?
just down in the launch pad, Nick. So I'm here with Olivia Price, McKnight and Harry Morton, the mighty Clean Made team. Tell us a little bit about what happened out there, Liv.
We were pretty set up for the big win to come in. We were on the little main, us and Euroflex, so I think we were the only two. But we were ready for it. And then just as we went into the sequence for that false start, we made a quick decision to swap to the big main and be like everyone else. And I think we were kind of regretting that decision. You know, we didn't get any racing in. It is pumping down here. You know, we thought it was going to come in, but not this much. It's insane.
I was about to ask you if you thought that it was going to get this windy. You're expecting to go 40 knots today?
Yeah, if we were out there, it would be brutal. I think, you know, it got quite bumpy as soon as we went sails down. We were one of the first ones, we were prepped for it. So once that breeze went left and it got really hot, we were feeling this could be big. This could be bigger than we were expecting.
Josh McKnight's a Moth World Champion. The Moth pioneered the foiling technology. Josh, tell us a little bit about the dangers of this type of boat in this sort of breeze.
Yeah, so like Olivia said, we changed down to the little sails, and that's something that'll help us get around the course. The 18s have been doing it for years with their rigs. But with this, we'll actually just reduce drag and we'll go faster. So the danger is basically water impact and then running into bits of the boat in front of you, people falling off. Just a bit of a safety issue. So we just wanted to look after that. We actually sort of hedged our bets a little bit. We went big jib, little main, which is probably a bit of an unusual call, but we just wanted to keep the area up because we weren't really sure when the breeze was going to come in.
What's the key to sailing these boats, the Superfoilers in particular?
I think communication, working as a team is a big thing. Yeah, it's a big team aspect. And then just being in tune with what each person's going to do and, you know, talking Olivia through like the buttons and what we're feeling on the boat, because sometimes you can lose a bit of feel when you step off trapeze. So just, yeah, lots of feedback and communication.
I'll get to you in a minute, Harry, but Olivia, I'm going to come back to you. The sensation of flying and the third dimension that it's brought to your sailing, you're an Olympic silver medalist. Tell us about what it's like getting your head around flying the boat.
Today was my 8th time on board the Superfoiler, so still massive learning curve. Playing the buttons I'm getting used to now, and it really is about just trying to keep that boat level. So you're constantly pressing buttons, you know, every 1 second, 2 second, you know, whether it be the rudder or the board, it really is a constant thing. We went downwind today, 3-point foiling. We've done a lot of 4-point in the series, so we just wanted to give it a try. And yeah, it felt quite comfortable. You know, it's a different feeling again. You're going a bit faster, sailing a bit higher, and we were just trying to figure out a different groove. So initially it was a big acceleration and I was a little bit nervous, but once we got used to it, you get a bit desensitized from the speed. So it was really good just to give it a go and see what we were doing.
So Harry, over to you. This is the grunt on the boat. He's a big lad, one of Australia's up-and-coming champions. Tell us about your experience on the Superfoiler so far.
Yeah, it's been pretty awesome. I had to miss the first round due to other commitments, but basically the whole time of the way I was just wishing I was there, and now I'm here. It's awesome. We've hit some new top speeds for myself and I think the crew as well, and like we said today, we're doing some 3-point foiling, and yeah, I think we hit about 28 knots or something in 10 knots of breeze, so just unbelievable. It's crazy.
What do you do up in the bow? You know, I've seen Goobs pressing buttons and swinging low. What's your role?
Yeah, a little bit of pressing buttons, foils up and down, and yeah, swinging really hard on the jib, and just communication and strategy for the guys so they have as much feedback as they can to make their jobs easier. So yeah, that's basically about it.
And do these two behind you bicker much? Are you like piggy in the middle or what?
Nah, it's not too bad. I mean, everyone has little disagreements, but overall on the boat we get along well, and yeah, as you can see, they're getting along all right there, so nah, it's all good.
You guys have been sailing together for years and years and known each other since kids. How are you guys going at the moment?
Yeah, you know, Josh and I have known each other since we were about 13, so we're very close. A little bit like brother-sister. We do have a little bit of disagreements every now and then, just about our opinions on the boat, but that's just because we've got, you know, so many inputs, and we have different ways of doing things, but, you know, at the end of the day, we're all working for the same team and we're all working just as hard. So I think, you know, I think it's a good thing. I think it's healthy, and you know, if we were all just agreeing, then I don't think we'd be getting the most out of the boat.
Final question. What are your expectations for Sydney? I mean, you're on a steep learning curve. Tell us about what you guys talk about and what you're aiming to achieve come Sydney Grand Final.
Obviously, the Sydney event, the grand final, is the pinnacle of this series. So we're really trying to ramp up our manoeuvres and our communication within the team to really peak at that event. So double points are up for grabs throughout that whole series. And I think it's going to be a really healthy competition between all six boats. You know, by that stage, I think the quality of the sailing and the quality of the fleet is going to be through the roof. So it's going to be really exciting. And I think for us, you know, we want to knock Euroflex off the top.
Great stuff, Liv. So I'm going to wander over to the pavement team. I'll go back to you for 2 seconds, Nick.
Thanks very much, Jack. And obviously good to see Josh McKnight was worried about the wind conditions because he was still in his helmet there. That's how crazy it is down there with the wind. So we're looking at Tech 2 now. We've got Luke Parkinson just making sure everything's in order down there as they get their boat back in. But I think every single sailor probably would have taken today if they knew they'd be level on points after Saturday with Euroflex. They'd feel like that was a bit of a win.
Yeah, for sure. Look, they're all going to have a few mixed emotions here. Some teams like the big breeze and some teams like the light wind. And so it's a win for some and maybe not for others, but that's just all part of sailing. You're often at the mercy of the race officer and the breeze, and we'll see how this all plays out.
And in many ways, I mean, there's just even more on the line now, given that it is double points. And Jack's made his way to another team. Jack, who are you with at the moment?
I just jump on the front, mate.
I'm here with the pavement team. So I've got the bare-chested Steve Thomas. I've got Dan Morris and Reece Mara. These guys have had a fair bit of time in the boat. They were part of our test team, these two in particular, and Dan's come in recently. Guys, are you happy that we're off the water, or would you be like to be out there sending it?
I think we came in at the right time, to be honest. It came pretty thick and fast, so it was good call to come in. But one day we'd love to really push the boats. Maybe not second day of the second event, mate.
How are you progressing, Stevie? The team obviously has done a lot of sailing with Reece. Dan's come in. How are you guys tracking at the moment?
Yeah, really well. You know, we're learning a lot every day. Like you said, we were part of the development of the boat, but now we're learning about how to actually race and handle the boats. A lot of the development was purely just getting the systems to run smoothly. So now we're just like day one again for us, and super stoked to get out there every day and learn heaps and feel like always progressing.
So apparently Nick's got a question for me to pass on to you, Stevie. Go ahead, Nick.
Yeah, absolutely right. Thanks, Jack. I was wondering if Stevie's taken his shirt off to try and help us with our viewers.
So the question is, Stevie, have you taken your shirt off to try and help us with the viewers?
Thanks, Nick. you should get a few thousand more hits now.
All right, well, we'll jump over to Dan Morris. So Dan, out from the States, a 49er expert, so very accustomed to being on the wire. What's it like being on the wire of a Superfoiler versus a 49er?
I think just a lot more risk being on the wire on the Superfoiler. And that's what you were going to see today in the big breeze, was that you're going to have big crashes, even just straight line sailing.
Talk us through, when you say risk, what does that mean? Is it the acceleration, the speed? Talk us through it.
Yeah, it's the acceleration when you slow down. It's going full speed and coming to a quick stop when something goes wrong with the foils or whatever it may be. It's risk of injury. That's the risk.
What's the magic carpet feeling like for you, the third dimension of flying?
Oh, we were talking about it yesterday. It's the best thing there is. Like, if you didn't enjoy yesterday, you don't like sailing. It was, and today would have been probably more of the same until it got real. Thought today might be a bit of the Type 3 fun, where it might not have been fun at the moment, but the stories afterward would have been pretty good.
You're very right. Now we're over to the rock star, Reesey, otherwise known as the Rocket Man. You may or may not have seen that on the YouTube. It's had thousands of, maybe millions of hits. Reesey, how are you progressing in the Superfoiler?
I think, like Steve said, we just started at day one again. Now we've got the boats fully functioning and we're racing against these guys, so we're just trying to learn as quick as we can and keep up with the other guys.
You've been on the journey since June last year. You came in at a very critical time in the project and developed the boat with Steve and Ewan McNichol and spent a lot of time on Sydney Harbour developing the boat. How happy are you to be here now racing against all these other teams?
I mean, at times you were sitting there thinking, oh, I don't know if this could work. And then when the six boats turned up in Adelaide, it was really good to see. And then to go around the course with six boats was a massive step forward for this project. And it's good to have some good guys around here. There's a few bad guys around here, Ed Powies, for example, but it's good to have a few guys out here and sailing fast with them all.
Who do you have the biggest rivalry in the park?
Oh, I think you want to beat Nathan Goobs mostly. And Glenn, they're just really good sailors, and been sailing against Nathan Goobs back in the 49er for the last 5 or 6 years, so it'd be good to get one up over them here.
I'm going to jump back to Stevie. That brings me back to the Rio Olympics. Reese and yourself did a lot of training against Nathan and Goobs in the 49er in Rio. Tell us a little bit about that and what you learned about your arch rivals.
We did a little stint in the test event. I think it was 2 years before the games, so quite a long way out. But they, you know, from 2 years out, they were doing a lot of research on the tides and the winds patterns, and you know, a lot of filming, and they were very methodical. So you know, they definitely tick all the boxes, and that's something we're trying to do too.
I think you told me once before that you were much faster than them upwind. Is that right?
Always.
And I also hear that you used to sneak a few sandwiches out of the hotel before heading down to sailing. Is that true?
Yeah, I can't lie. It's always good practice to make use of the free buffet and the, you know, I get hungry at lunch, so an extra sandwich or two at breakfast always goes a long way.
Okay, and finally, you've definitely got the most colourful boat in the fleet, the Golden Egg. Tell us about Pavement and how the ship's going.
Oh, mate, she's a beaut. As you can see, the gold colour kind of blends in with my nice complexion, and I think the rainbow suits Reese and his orientation, so I think we're all good.
Very politically correct. Thanks, Steve. Okay, we're going to move on. I'm going to go over to the Red Rocket. Thanks, guys. Well done.
Great stuff. And of course, Pavement is a children's clothing manufacturer. They've got some really nice designs. Maybe they can make a bigger size for Steve, but he's a real character. A Sydney to Hobart winner aboard Ichiban this year. And well, he needs to work on the tan though, I think. We can all agree on that, can't we, Tess?
Yeah, we can. Look, Steve's from Perth, so he's, you know, from that weather over there, but he's done it. Look, he's done a good job. He's, you know, steering in the 49er, you've got to be quite small, but as they progress, you know, into boats like the Superfoiler, you know, that muscle's just critical. So a lot of the guys have really, you know, had to bulk up and work hard on getting stronger. But look, James and I have just checked the live wind readings out on the race course, and we've seen in the outer harbour, we've just had a gust through of 34 knots. So I think it's a good thing that the boats came in when they did, because it's so windy out there.
It is windy out there, and they're all happy to be back at the launch pad. And Jack has someone else down there. Who have you found?
So I've got the Tech 2 team here. I've got Aidan Menzies, Luke Parkinson and Sam Newton. So, guys, you had a big week. I'll start with you, Aidan. Tell us what happened and what it's taken to get the boat back on the water in the last 7 days.
Yeah, well, last week we ripped the stern off the boat. There's a pretty spectacular footage of that. And all week, the shore team and the behind-the-scenes team have stuck the transom back on and done a huge amount of effort. Superfoiler shore team has done an outstanding effort to get us back on the water, and we're out there ready to go. So, yeah, great work by everyone to do it, and we're back together ready to roll.
Aidan, you're on the shore team for Artemis America's Cup Racing team, which Luke Parkinson was also part of. Now you're sailing with him. Tell us how that's going.
It's quite good, I guess. I've got a little bit more of an understanding of behind-the-scenes stuff, and Luke's got the sailing aspect, so it's working really well together, and, we're working really well as a team.
You used to sail with Nathan Outeridge a long time ago. What were you sailing, and what can you bring into this regatta and knowing what they're doing and how to beat them?
I sailed with Nathan on a 29er and 420 through our youth days. Gives me a little bit of an edge. I know the way he thinks and things like that, so doesn't make it any easier to catch him, but at least I sort of generally know what he's thinking. So just bringing that little bit of knowledge and, just trying to get through.
So we'll move over to Parko. Parko, I've done a lot of sailing with you. I know exactly what you're like. You really push boats and you like going fast and you're not really afraid of much. Tell us what's the Superfoil is bringing you and the enjoyment that you're getting from it.
Yeah, today we actually had one of our funnest runs. Initially when we got out there, we just bore away doing 30, 31 next to the Pavement guys. Maybe I do push the boat a little bit hard sometimes, so it's just trying to manage that now and choosing when to put the right foot down.
So you say 30, 31 knots, how much breeze were you in?
Probably 12 to 15. We still had the big jib and the big main on, so there's plenty left in the gill. So we'll just wait till we get the right conditions and really see what it can do.
So obviously you missed a few days sailing in the first event. Now it's a bit of catch up. What's your philosophy or your approach to these next few days and the next regatta?
So we've learnt a lot from the video footage of the manoeuvres, and we feel like we're going okay on the manoeuvres, and we're not losing that much there. But it's just the racing practice that we really missed from Adelaide, and just catching up on that as quickly as we can.
So moving over to Sam. Sam's a seven-time JJ Giltinan winner. He beat me many times, unfortunately, on the Channel 7 18 footer. But Sam, you were part of the Oracle America's Cup team. Now you're part of the Artemis America's Cup team, sort of. Tell us what the dynamic's like.
No, look, it's good sailing with these guys. I like watching them, battle it out between them, little arguments here and there. But I'm new with these guys, but I've got a good team, good skipper. He's really good on the helm, and having Aiden in the middle, completes the package. So just need to get out there and do some races and show what we've got. Yeah.
So you haven't been bickering on board, these two?
No, they're not too bad. I think we're pretty solid. So we just need some more races. My first day back on board today. Unfortunately, didn't get a race underway, but probably a bit windy out there for any boat. So yeah, probably a big call, good call.
You're in the bow on the America's Cup, from memory, or close to the bow. You're in the bow of the Superfoiler. Tell us the differences, the similarities. What's it like?
Doing similar sort of position. That was physical. This is a different type of physical. Still playing with the boards. Everything about this is, relates to the cup boats. It's very similar. The dynamics of foiling, using the rudders and the boards. And to be honest, these boats are not that far off the pace of them. I think once we get in some decent breeze, we're going to be, closing that sort of high 30s. Pretty similar.
That's pretty extreme on the trapeze. What were you doing hanging upside down last weekend?
I don't know, just, got my footing wrong and, got the boat a little loose. But next time I think we'll be a bit more settled, we'll get through those situations.
Great stuff, guys. Well, thanks for giving me a few minutes. We'll look forward to seeing you on the water tomorrow. Back to you, Nick.
Thanks very much, Jack. Sam Newton is a man of few words, sort of a gentle type of guy, but he is an incredible sailor. And as Jack mentioned, he was part of the Oracle setup and America's Cup winner in San Francisco. And while he might be quiet, I imagine when he does talk, people would sit up and take notice, Tessa.
Yeah, he's just one of those sailors that everyone respects. And, right back from the first team we spoke to, the importance of communication and teamwork and, really bonding together. But I think it's also important to have the right balance of personalities on board. If you have three people that are really fiery and out there, it just doesn't evil out. So I think Sam's a really good sort of neutral, calm, like you said, anything that he does say, people take seriously and really listen to his key words. And although communication's important on board these boats, you can't be talking all the time. It's just saying the right amount of information in the shortest possible way at the right time that's super critical, because the boats are so physically demanding.
Yeah, he probably needs to not say too much, because you wouldn't get a word in with Aiden Menzies. So I can barely get a word in when Jack McCartney's around, so I'll just go straight to him, Jack.
Thanks, Tricky Nicky. So I'm here with Glenn Ashby. Glenn, you've been smashing everyone to date. You've got a lot of local knowledge. You're from Melbourne. Tell us what happened out there. Were you expecting this much pressure today?
Yeah, no, not at all. I mean, we knew that there was a bit of a change coming through, but I think the strength and the velocity that when it did come through, I think caught everybody by surprise. So, around sort of 17 to 20 knots was really what everyone thought it was going to be and what the forecasters thought it was going to be. But, 25 to 30 out there is, too windy for any water, any water activities really. So, unfortunately for us, no racing today, but, we had absolutely fantastic day yesterday, and I think, very, very lucky to get those three races in superb conditions. And this is sailing, it's weather, Mother Nature doing its thing, and unfortunately for everybody out there today, we didn't get any racing in.
We saw the record point push you right to the line in the last race yesterday, but apart from that, you've been a long way in front. What are you guys doing right?
Yeah, look, it's been an interesting learning experience for for everybody, and I think the moth sailing, the ACAT sailing, a little bit of GC32, and obviously the America's Cup sailing for Nathan, Ian and myself. You've got to take a lot of those different aspects and put all that together, and I think the last sort of few years for us sailing a lot of foiling boats, I think has been possibly a little advantage for us. But these boats are new and we're all learning, and the other guys are learning very, very quickly, so we're having some fantastic racing, and to be able to sail and stretch your legs in some flatter water and some more open venues is absolutely brilliant. So really, really enjoying the yachting.
So Nick in the office has a question for you. Go ahead, Nick.
Thanks, Jack. I wanted to get an insight from Glenn as to how nice it is to be racing on Corio Bay so close to friends and family. I saw his girls are down here today.
So he saw that you got your daughters down and your wife down here today. These are your home waters on Corio Bay. Is it nice to be here racing on the Superfoiler Grand Prix?
Yeah, look, absolutely. I guess as the only Victorian here in the competition, it's fantastic to be sailing here in Geelong. A lot of family support, got a lot of friends here that have come down to have a look at the boats and also to look at the sailing. So, really enjoying, having a summer at home, and, everybody are super impressed with the boats here. And, fingers crossed tomorrow we're going to get some great racing in. So, looking forward to that.
How have you been adjusting to this boat, having come straight out of the America's Cup only a few months ago? You were trimming the wing on the winning America's Cup machine. Now you're on this, you're pulling ropes. What sort of techniques can you bring across from that and the difficulty involved in sailing the Superfoiler?
Yeah, look, there is a lot of similarities between quite a few of the foiling boats. Obviously, the soft sail versus the hard wing is a different beast. But having grown up sailing soft sails, being a sailmaker, you do get to have a little bit of an understanding of how things should work. Really, the boats are difficult to sail. Very easy to get stalled and park the boats, and very easy to roll the boats out to windward or to leeward. So your trimming accuracy is very, very important to get the boats around the track cleanly. As is the crew combination collectively between the three crew on board, the helmsman and the two crew forward. You really have to be working as one, and I think that's one of the really exciting parts of this boat. You're standing on the side of the thing, you've got the breeze in your face, you're not in a cockpit, you're literally sailing sort of an open wheeler type environment where you really are out in the open, and that's extremely exciting. Whilst the speeds aren't quite as high as the America's Cup sailing, it actually feels like you're going faster a lot of the time because you literally are just lying above the water, and it's a sensational feeling.
For all the sailing diehards out there, tell us a little about the roles on board and what Nathan, yourself and Goobs are doing at any one time.
Yeah, look, straight lining, Nathan's steering the boat most of the time. He's using the buttons on the tiller to actually control the rudders and the daggerboard pitch to keep the boat foiling sort of stably pitch-wise. I'm trimming the traveller and the mainsail a lot of the time for roll moment for the yacht, and also for speed and modes. And Goobs is pulling all the other strings on board, the jib car, Cunningham, mast rotation. We do a little bit crossing over. He also plays the traveller when I'm doing the main together. So really it is, it's like, you have to work as one boat with six arms going flat out. There's a lot of strings to pull, but that's what makes it fun and enjoyable. And to be able to do that together with your mates, having a bit of a laugh and, enjoying the sailing is something that we all have really been looking forward to. And, fantastic yachting, and something I think in the future we'll look back on and say, well, that was a great period.
I was out on the Sydney Harbour watching you guys go around a few weeks ago in a windy nor'easter. I was asked earlier in this interview that what the top speed is for the Superfoiler, and I had a conversation with you. What do you think the top speed is that you've done?
Yeah, it's a great question. We didn't have the Velocitech on that day, but I'd say sort of mid to high 30s, I think, was probably where we tapped out. I think in the flatter water venues in Big Breeze, you could potentially hit that 40 knot mark quite comfortably, but unfortunately we just haven't had quite the conditions to do that. But certainly in Sydney Harbour, in the waves, in that mid to high 30s when you're trapezing is certainly a hairy ride.
You had a hairy moment that day too. Tell us about the nosedive you did and what happened.
Yeah, look, we did. We got a bit high on the foils, sort of trying to get up around the Manly ferry in a bit of swell, and basically punched the boat out of the water a little bit, ventilated the leeward foil, and basically went down the mine at over 30 knots. So Ian actually ended up swinging around the front, actually up above the rig, and ejected, looking down at the boat, and I sort of crashed, went around the front of the thing, and ended up getting washed up on the leeward side. So it sort of felt like you're in a bit of a washing machine ride for a while, but we managed to get the boat back in one piece, and hopefully we won't do that again.
So local knowledge tomorrow, what can we expect weather-wise? Is this going to blow through and become more steady for us, or is it going to hang in there?
Yeah, look, I think tomorrow we should end up with a much cooler, denser breeze coming from the southwest once the breeze actually fills in. I think it'll be in the high teens, hopefully, you know, in the raceable limits. Generally, a southwester here in Geelong is a fantastic sailing breeze. Flat water, some really, really, really good rides downwind, and all being well, we'll have some fantastic racing tomorrow.
Finally, looking towards the future, you know, Sydney Grand Final, you guys are obviously setting the pace early on. What are you guys expecting for the Sydney event, and who's going to be pushing you to the limits?
Yeah, look, obviously we've seen some, you know, a lot of the teams sort of get up there and have their day. Feel, obviously, you know, massive improvement from Adelaide to here. Same with CJ, you know, they're sailing very, very consistently. And I think as we get each day, each hour, all the teams are going to improve. And I think by the time Sydney comes around, I think any one of the teams could be in the front running for sure.
Thanks very much, Glennie. I can't see your other lads. They must be off in the showers already, so... Nick, back to you for a sec, and then I'll go and find the record point team.
What a treat. I mean, Glenn Ashby has won more world championships than I've had hot dinners, and he's an America's Cup champion as well. How nice is it for the other sailors to be able to call on his expertise and just share knowledge with someone who is really the Roger Federer of this sport?
Yeah, look, it's quite amazing to have the guys from... Without a question, the absolute top of the sport. They are absolutely leading the way in all this foiling technology. And I know they've been very open with a lot of teams. You know, there's a vast range of experience and age across the fleet. And, you know, they're a great bunch of blokes. They're everyone's mate. And they're just like the rest of us. They're out there to have fun, go fast. And you know, they're just being incredibly generous with their knowledge. And you know, everyone's just going to... really want to take it to them, and they're up for the challenge, and hopefully we'll see that in some events to come.
Absolutely. The battles will be heating up come tomorrow. Tessa, I mean, it's a real delight to have the world's best here in Geelong.
Yeah, the talent depth throughout this fleet's just phenomenal, you know. I think, you know, the boats have just done the job themselves. The design, it's, you know, pushing leading technology worldwide. You know, this is the first trimaran superfoiler with soft sails, as Glenn pointed out, and the, you know, three people trapezing, which is different to the cut boats. And I think, you know, as soon as these sailors, you know, saw these boats that had been built, you know, they... you know, knew, you know, want to have a go on this superfoiler. I want to race this. I want to be the ones on the boats. And, you know, it's brought them all to Australia, which is really cool. And, you know, they're going to help a lot in the development of getting these boats to really reach their optimum performance.
And they're already there. They're so close to really hitting that top speed. And I know someone that caught everyone off guard yesterday was Phil Robertson. And Jack is down there with record point.
I am. I'm with the record team. So we've got Phil Robertson here, the skipper. Sam Phillips is on the main sheet, and Neil Hunter with the big guns in the bow. So we'll kick off with you, Phil. You had an excellent day yesterday. You must be really pleased with that.
Yeah, we are. We're actually really stoked with the day. All top three finishes, which is what you want to achieve. And found some really nice modes, which we're probably more stoked about. And look, I think we're making big steps forward. And yeah, we just got to keep making them.
I know you're a determined man, but... that was a big improvement from Adelaide. I think the afternoon out on Thursday, you seemed to kick some goals and get some confidence in a bit of breeze.
Yeah, we did actually. We spent a good day on Thursday, and it was just good prep from the shore side, and managed to get a good little training session out and some pretty puffy and breezy stuff, which built the confidence a bit and got us all settled together, because we're, I guess, a new team for this event with Sam joining us. And yesterday we managed to get sort of all the buttons right on the foils and... yeah, get the boat ripping, so it was very nice, and yeah, quite a good spot to be in. And we're getting closer to the blue boat, the little dream team, and now they'll go down soon, and I'm sure everyone's going to make some massive steps over the next couple of days as well.
What is the dream team doing right, and what do you need to do to improve and beat them?
Oh mate, they've just got so much experience, and boats similar, sort of foiling and small boats, and yeah, we're catching up, you know, I think everyone's catching up, and they just do the little things right, they're really switched on, so... a pretty top world-class sailors, I think you could say. And look, it's great having them here, because we're learning off them, and we can watch them and see what they're doing and chuck it into our playbook as well. So it's good to have them, and for sure we're going to take them down soon.
You're a world match racing champion. You've had a lot of experience with the GC32s, which are a semi-foiling cat. Tell us what the superfoiler is like and how this fits in.
mate, if a GC32 is now a semi-foiler, then I'm scared for the future. It's very different. These are quite small. I think your platform's probably only 14 foot or something, and your centre hull's 24 foot, I'm guessing. But it feels like a little 14 foot magic carpet you're sort of sailing on, and it's pretty sensational once you're up and ripping. And it's kind of scary at first because the boat is so small and going so fast. And look, we're sailing around upwind easily 20 knots on the foil going uphill, and I don't know when you're a kid, but you used to hate going upwind, but now it's probably quite a little bit more enjoyable because it's not quite as fast. But no, it's good. It's a fantastic boat and definitely the future sort of this extreme foiling. Yeah.
Thank you, Phil. Moving on to Sam. So Sam, you're a highly experienced 49er campaigner, part of the Australian sailing team. You've jumped on and had an instant impact. Tell us what your initial impressions are of the Superfoiler.
Like you said, it was only my first day on the Superfoiler yesterday. Awesome boats, like unbelievably fun, fast, and being on trapeze, going that fast is definitely a new experience and pretty awesome. These guys, Neil and Phil, they made it pretty easy for me coming in only my second day yesterday, so it was pretty good to get some good results.
What's the key to sailing this thing?
I'll tell you when we figure it out, I think. I don't think we're quite there yet. But, I don't know. I think, you know, just having stable fly height was an important thing yesterday. We're still in the learning process. I think everyone is to some extent. So I think it'll be a matter of the team that learns quickest does the best.
Have you had much foiling experience previous to this? What's the sensation of flying?
I've sailed a moth a little bit. Sailed the moth for a couple of years, I guess. But other than that, that's it. So nothing as big as this, nothing as heavy as this. And of course, in the moth, you're not on trapeze, so different experience.
Heavy's a tough word on the Superfoiler. it's a bit rough. Neil, over to you, mate. So probably the biggest axe in the bow on all of these boats. Tell us how you're going and how you're enjoying sailing with Phil and Sam.
Yeah, I mean, it's been awesome to step in. Phil called me up. I was actually in Australia already doing some GC32 sailing, and Phil called me up and asked me if I wanted to come super foiling, and it's been an awesome experience. It's great to step into a new class like this and do something new. It's been really cool, yeah, and I think everybody's just learning how to sail the boats, and the amount of development that's going on and the way they're sailing the boats every day is just massive, so it's really cool, actually, yeah.
Tell us a bit about your experience with foiling. What other classes have you done, and how does that relate to what you're doing now?
I've done quite a lot of GC32 sailing in the past, and I also did the America's Cup with Land Rover BAR last year, so I've got a reasonable amount of foiling experience, and I think it's all relatable. Obviously, this is all a bit new with the three hulls and everything, and it changes the dynamic a bit, but it's really interesting to learn how to sail these boats.
I can't imagine you're on the pumps on the BAR America's Cup boat, but is this boat as physical as the America's Cup 50s?
The racing in Adelaide in the river was bloody hard work, but probably not as hard work as sailing an AC50, I don't think. But still, it's up there in the front when you're pulling the boards up and down. It's up there for sure.
So what's it going to take to get a result in Geelong tomorrow? What's the priorities on the racetrack?
I guess we've got three races just to try and keep it clean and just do what we did yesterday, really, which was just keep it super clean, get the boat locked in. We had really nice mode upwind, and then just choosing when to go three-point foiling downwind. I think the Euroflex guys have got a bit of a step up on everybody with that, just choosing when to lift that windward board and go to the three-point foiling, get it absolutely charging downwind. So I think that's going to be where it's at tomorrow, and we'll see how we go.
Thanks, guys. Thanks for your time. Go the record point. We look forward to some big results tomorrow. Keep it up.
Sam and Neil taking a leaf out of Steve's book there, opting for the shirtless interview. And by my calculations, that means we've got January, February and March in our topless calendar already locked away. Are you putting your hand up, Jimmy, for the next month?
No, I'll leave it to those guys.
Well, we've got to find April. I'm sure we'll do that. Tess Parkinson, tomorrow's double points up for grabs. So that could, I would imagine, increase the likelihood of someone toppling Euroflex to take out our Geelong regatta.
Yeah, look, the portion of races in these regattas that are going to count for double points now after being blown out today is, you know, pretty significant. So it's all about tomorrow, and you know, hopefully no one's broken too much out on the water today, so they haven't got too much boat work to do, and they can, you know, get packed up, get changed, get a bit of rest, get home early, and be, you know, super fresh to take on tomorrow.
That's a wonderful aerial view of our launch pad, our pit lane, and Jack McCartney has got Ian Jensen by his side.
I've got Ian Jensen by my side. I found Glenn earlier still in his wetsuit. What are you doing in civilian clothes already? Have you just left Glenn to do all the work?
No, I don't think that's the case. But, yeah, we pulled her up and I just ducked off for a quick shower.
So you guys are going really well at the moment. Tell us what's working and why you're in front and why you're flying the boat so steadily.
I think Nate's used to pressing buttons to fly a boat. It's a bit different to a moth or a conventional boat where it's so it's probably a bit new for a few of the guys, but we've also probably done the most sailing as well. We had a few days in Sydney. I'm sure it won't take long for everyone else to get used to it and get up to speed.
That was a bit of a mistake giving you guys a bit more time, wasn't it? But what's the key to sailing this boat and your role in the bow? We've said it before, you play with the buttons. Tell us what it's like piloting this thing.
Yeah, so in a straight line I'm normally doing control the Cunningham, the Traveller and the Jib, and then Glennie's doing the main. And then in the manoeuvres I do the boards up and down and flying the boat a little bit with the buttons up the front.
I saw that you had the little gear up for a brief moment. How did it feel? That's the first time we've actually seen it on the boat. How was it?
Yeah, we thought we'd just throw it up to have a look. It was a bit light at the time, but saw the forecast for the next couple of days and thought we might just check it all fits. But yeah, it was it's significantly different. It's felt quite good upwind, and we would have had 14 knots, but pretty underwick downwind. So I think you'll need a little bit to pull it up.
So what will be the crossover then?
This stage, thinking maybe 15 or 16, probably around the course is a crossover.
What are you expecting for tomorrow? 15, 16, a bit more?
A few different forecasts. Clouds has got it a bit more, and Predict Wind's got quite good racing at sort of 12 to 14. So we'll just have to see.
So we saw a record point push you right to the line yesterday. Who are you expecting to keep improving and chase you guys and improve a lot over the next few days?
I think Tech 2 had a bit of a tough day yesterday. I'd be looking for something from those guys in the tomorrow. They were second and third at a couple of the last top marks, and they got a bit shafted on the downwind. A little bit unlucky, I guess. And I think with a bit more breeze, those boys will come in strong. I think Parker will push the boat hard And yeah, I think they'll show some big improvement. And obviously record points come a long way since last event, so I'm sure Phil will be pushing us hard as well.
So you had a very busy year last year. You did the America's Cup, then you rolled into the Rio Olympics, or one before the other. What's the plans for this year? Are you on holidays, or tell us a little bit about 2018?
To be honest, I've got this for the next little bit, and then a little bit of RC44 sailing with Artemis, and then hopefully that winds into a high performance circuit a little later. But we still no real decisions as to Artemis's future at the moment.
Thanks, Goobs. Thanks for your time. Good luck tomorrow. I hope someone beats you. I mean, I didn't say that, but we'll catch you soon.
Someone will soon.
And just on the tail end of that, Goobs was saying someone will soon, and you get the feeling it'll happen sooner rather than later. Tessa Parkinson, you'd hate to play poker with Ian Jensen. He gives nothing away.
Yeah, he's he's quietly spoken, Goobs. And yeah, no, great guy, very, very calm as well on the boat. And yeah, he's just, look, he's renowned for being an amazing trimmer, actually. His trimming skills are, he's really, I think he's actually quite underrated as a sailor. He's like just, you know, done a lot of dinghy stuff growing up. Awesome crew in the 49er. Got really, really good balance and really nice trimming skills. So having him on the boat's just, you know, really, really cool for the team.
Oh, no doubt about that. I mean, you look at what he's achieved already in the sport with a gold medal, and of course his role with Artemis in the last America's Cup. He's a man who lets his actions speak louder than his words. Probably enough words from us today. We've really enjoyed your company as we say goodbye from Geelong on behalf of Tessa, Jimmy and Jack. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you tomorrow.